Before coming to work here at Boris Effects, I once had the opportunity to work on a feature documentary called My Father and the Man in Black, a story about Johnny Cash and his second manager. Part of my job was to put together rough comps for the motion graphics team, where they would basically take photos, bring them into Photoshop to cut out the subjects, then have to clone the background, and then bring this inside of After Effects, separating the layers and adding a camera move. This process took days to complete per photo. It recently got me thinking, how has this workflow changed in the age of AI and generative AI? So that's what this tutorial is about. In part one, we're going to take a look at how we can easily make these cutouts happen using the generative tools, not to mention the easy selection tools. We'll then take out our cutout photos and bring them to life in After Effects using Boris Effects' Continuum and Sapphire package, including adding light leaks, adding blurs, not to mention other dust-based treatments. Let's get started and see what we can do with these photos inside of Photoshop. Okay, I'm here inside of Photoshop with the photo that I want to do a treatment on. I would like to cut out the three subjects here in the photo, including Johnny Cash, then clone out the background, and in addition, make sure that this photo is ready for an HD treatment or 16:9. So in order to start the process, first of all, I'll come over here to the Layers tab and double click that to make this into a layer instead of a background. And I always like to duplicate my layers, so I'm just pressing Command J, so I have a duplicate copy. I can always go back to the original if needed, especially with some of this Gen AI process that we'll use for when we extend the photo. In this specific case, I'm actually going to head over to my toolbar and select the crop tool. At the top of the Photoshop window, you'll see that I've already set the aspect ratio to be 1920 by 1080. And this is why I'm ending up with these bars right here. But I want to make sure to encompass the entire photo. So I'm going to extend this in size and then reposition the photo. So I really don't want that black at the bottom. I want to make sure to get it just a little bit more of the photo here at the top. This is looking really good. Now, this active navigation bar here at the bottom will allow me to enter into a text prompt asking what I'd like to see there in the background. In this case, I'm just going to type in wall and couch. And let's just generate and see what it comes up with. It's going to analyze what's inside the photograph, especially the edges, and try to come up with something that will blend the new cropped generative fill with this original photo. Okay, so this is what it's come up with. That is one of three options that we get. And if I use these arrows, I can see the next option. That looks pretty good too. And here's the final option. Out of these, I kind of like option number two. So this is great. And in this case, because I want to take the generative fill layer, which is now available in the Layers tab, I'll turn that off and on, and combine it with the original layer. I'm going to take this, duplicate it, just save a duplicate copy of my generative fill if I need to go back to it, and then select these two layers, actually combine them. Now, before I do, I have to take the layer with the generative fill on it and rasterize it. And now I can select the other layer, right-click with both of them selected, and choose to merge them. Let's call this full photo, and I'm going to save this project out. Now that I have what I want to work with, it's time to focus in on cutting out the subjects. And for that, we're going to use the object selection tool. I'm going to switch from the crop tool here just to the tool above, which is the object selection tool, which has gotten much better with time. And you can see here, it automatically identifies Johnny Cash and the extension. Most of the second woman, minus her skirt, and quite a bit of the third person as well. I'm going to select Johnny Cash to start with him. We'll see those marching ants, and I'll zoom in here on the photo to see how good the overall selection was. So it wasn't perfect, but we can easily continue with the object selection tool. One thing to do is to hold down the shift key, and then you can try to expand that selection. So I'll try that there, and also with his signing of the autograph. And just pay attention to the marching ants. Another thing that I also like to work with is just underneath the object selection tool, For some refinement, the quick selection tool can be great. So in this case, I'm just going to use quick selection with no modifier key in order to add to this, making sure that I have the components of Johnny that I want, and also try to clean this up a bit. Now that I'm close to having the selection that I want, on the navigation bar here at the bottom, I'm going to click on the modify selection and go to select and mask. One of my favorite things about this window is your ability to see this mask in different ways. So here on the side in the properties panel, I'm going to go over to where it says view and click the downward arrow where we can see marching ants. Can even see shortcuts to them. You can see a black and white view. But in this case, I'll stick with overlay and then just bring down the opacity a bit. Now I'll use my command equal key to just zoom in on Johnny and continue with my paintbrush tool inside of the select and mask window to try to pick up elements that were left over. But selecting this black and white subject, this process has been sped up incredibly for this type of workflow. In order to remove areas that I don't want to select, I'm going to option click. I'll press command 0 now to zoom out and just double check that I have most of the selection that I want here. Make sure that middle part is also selected. I'm using the spacebar tool to navigate around the photo. I'm going to continue to option click here to have this area not included in the selection. I'll press command 0 just to get an overview of that selection one more time, and then use the properties panel there on the side to refine the selection. So I like to add a little bit of an edge detection radius of about 1 pixel and also enable smart radius. I'll make the feather increase to 0.3. I like to have a small feather there. And if needed, we could always change, shift the edge or the contrast. I can also see I picked up a little bit extra, so I'm going to use the option key just to make sure that that doesn't come around for the ride. Now, once you're happy with your selection, just at the bottom here, we can change the output to be rather than to the selection, the layer that's selected, to put this to another layer. And that's where we're going to have our cutout. I usually choose new layer or new layer with mask, depending on how flexible I want the workflow to be. New layer will be fine in this instance, and I'll press OK. And now we can see what's ended up here with our cutout. This is going to be pretty good for working with inside of After Effects. I'm now going to turn on the full photo, and we're going to continue making some additional selections. I'll turn off the cutout that I made, and now we're on to the center subject. I'll go back to the object selection tool, select the top of her, and then use the Shift plus key to try to extend that selection to also include her skirt and a bit of her leg. But this is going to need some refinement to make sure that this is going to be just right. Another option that we have is if they're employing optics in your workflow, which is several effects inside of Boris effects for still-based workflows and works inside of Photoshop, we can send it there and even use Easy Mask. If you do decide to send your layer to optics, it is easy. In the layers panel with it selected, simply head over to your filter menu. You can go to Boris Effects Optics. And if you're just looking to create a mask, look in the layers panel in Optics, which is in the top left-hand corner. There's a new plus icon specifically for adding a mask. And the one that we'd want to use in this case is Easy Mask, but we have several to choose from. Easy Mask starts off by providing you an area that you'd like to identify as the foreground. And this works similarly to other paintbrush tools inside of After Effects. You can use your right square bracket to make the brush bigger or your left square bracket to make it smaller. I'm going to now select the subject very loosely in this instance. And once I've defined her, I can then move here using the top panel, identifying areas of the background, which I don't want to include. I'll just make a few red paintbrush strokes. And once I'm satisfied, simply hit the cogwheel icon at the top to generate a mask. You'll see your thumbnail for masks update within the layers panel. Since this has a bit of inaccuracy, I'll continue to draw on areas here in the background that I don't want to include. And if I click the cogwheel again, the mask itself will update. Now to send this over into Photoshop, simply click the Export Masks button next to the layer that you'd like to bring over. Once that's done, click on the Apply button at the bottom of the interface. This is the masks that it's created. In this particular instance, we're not going to use this mask, so I'm going to undo by pressing Command-C, and we'll continue our mask workflow inside of Photoshop with the object selection. In this case, I'm just going to continue my work by heading back to the Select and Mask window, where I have my trusted overlays, and I'll add, as well as subtract, areas of this subject that I don't want. I can also see here at the bottom, I have Johnny Cash's fingers, which I don't want. I also want to make sure to include the subject's legs here at the bottom for the cutout movement. And now that I've refined that, I'm just going to repeat the steps like I did in part one where we cut out Johnny. Now that I've increased the smart radius, the feather, the radius, and chosen to export this out to a new layer, I'll press OK. And now we can see this subject. And just, it's also good to look at her with Johnny to make sure that there aren't any unwanted cutouts in this. But keep in mind that we will be also blending it in with the full photo, minus the areas that we will be adding a cloned background to. But right now, things are looking pretty good. I'm going to repeat this step with the third cutout. I'm going to command click the fan right, and then shift click both the middle fan and Johnny Cash. So all three of those are selected. I'm then going to option click the full photo, so that's selected and turned on only, and head over to the paint menu, where I'm going to choose to expand the selection by 4 pixels. This grows a little bit, so there won't be a line when I clone out the background. Next, I have a couple options here. One is I could try generative fill, and just to type in the word remove to see what it comes up with. Now, through my experience, generative fill has sometimes been a little bit random and not given me the results that I was looking for. A couple of these undesirable results. And in fact, I'm just going to remove the generative fill layer altogether. Command click the other two layers. Go back to my full photo. Make sure that this is expanded by 4 pixels again. But this time, head over to the paint bucket menu, where we do have an option for content aware fill. I'm just going to keep this as is. It's going to look at the entire image and the selection. I'll press OK. It's going to get to work and does a pretty good job of removing most of that content. Now we can fine tune this a bit better so it can work for our cutout treatment altogether, but we're off to a really good place. I'm going to go over to my marquee select tool. Just kind of go over around the hair of Johnny Cash and some of the residue of Johnny Cash's hair and the subject's hair, and then just use generative fill. I want to get to fix this up a bit. So that does a pretty good job with the new selections. And in fact, I like number 2. I'll do that one more time. Just around the couch. Generate. And now I have a fairly decent clone background, not to mention my 3 photo cutouts for my treatment. Now, just to add a little bit to this, I'm going to select Johnny and actually use one of Photoshop's neural filters to add some color. This is something that's available from the filter menu. Just choose neural filters. And with the Johnny Cash layer selected, I'm going to choose colorize. As you can see, it automatically adds a color treatment. You can also make additional adjustments by adjusting things like saturation or bringing that down a little bit. Alternatively, we could choose a style, so such as retro bright, which would give it a slightly different treatment. I'll make sure to bring down the color artifact reduction or noise reduction if there is some, and then have the option of either exporting it to the current layer or to a new layer altogether. I chose new layer in this instance so that I have a second layer which I could add some color to directly inside of After Effects if required. I'll just call this Johnny Color. Next, I'm just going to clean up the background. So I'm going to take my remaining generative fill layers and rasterize both of them, then select them along with the full photo background, where I'll merge them all together, renaming them background. Last but not least, I want to audition various film look effects that I might apply inside of After Effects using Boris Effects' Continuum. And one great thing is that there are effects shared between Continuum and Optics, which runs inside of Photoshop. So what I'm going to do is actually activate or option click the original layer here, because that's what I'm going to send over to Optics. I'm going to go to my filters, Boris Effects, Optics, and inside of here, I'm going to head to Film Lab, to one of my favorite effects, which is Film Stocks. Once you select an effect, such as film stocks, on the left-hand side are all of the presets this effect ships with, including ones that mimic various film emulsions, such as Eastman. Others that add different color tones to it. And once you find an effect that you like, such as this Fuji film look, I could head over to the right-hand side of the optics interface and start to play around with the parameters and perfect this. So in this case, I'm going to head to the bottom and actually just add a little bit of a vignette that I might want to apply. And this also has grain enabled, which makes film stocks a great effect. I'll just scale that up so that you can see it. But I'm going to make the grain in this case too. Once you make a tweak to any preset or parameter, you can save your own. And you can actually import these presets inside a continuum. So how this works is on the top of the parameters here, I'm going to go to Create Custom Preset, Fuji Film 35 with Vignette, and I'm going to press OK. That's going to show up here at the bottom of the presets list, but the best part is you can right-click it and choose to open the custom preset location. Here you can see the Fuji preset. Just so that you note, this is going to be saved in your Documents folder under Boris Effects Optics Presets, any custom presets that you save. Since I'm not going to use this inside of Photoshop, I'm just going to cancel out of Optics and leave this layer untouched. Now I'll turn on all of my other layers, and it's time to save out this file. Press Command S. Knowing that this is now a 1920 by 1080 file, I'll refer to this as Johnny Cache Cutout and save this quickly to my desktop. Using Photoshop's tools, as well as its savvy object selection, has made photo cutouts easier than ever. This, combined with narrow filters, as well as being able to leverage optics, can make some incredible workflows. Join me for part two, where I show you taking all of the layers that we just created and bringing them to life inside of After Effects. We're going to add a ton of effects from both Continuum and Sapphire. If you like this tutorial, don't forget to give it a thumbs up, subscribe, and I'll see you sometime soon.